here is the workflow to get printable reports for structure triage to give back to the home unit. So the first thing that we need to do is to bring in the mobile service. And so what we'll do is we'll go to portal. And as I mentioned before, favoriting the feature services that you'll be using in Pro is highly recommended. Searching for a feature service can be a bit tedious when people have been making copies and things like that. So today we're gonna work with the training GISS edit service, not the mobile service. And then we'll add it to the map. And then you'll wanna zoom in and be sure to download only the features that you are interested in. So I've got my, these are my test points. But if you're on an incident, just make sure that the features that you want the reports to include are in your map area, and then you'll download the map. But when you do that, check this little box right here and click on that, and you can make sure where your download, where your offline maps are being stored. So this is where I know to look for them. Download this map. Sometimes it takes a minute. And this will create a mobile geodatabase. And I've tested this week using the mobile geodatabase to create the reports. But unfortunately, using the mobile geodatabase instead of a file geodatabase produces some unexpected issues in the legend and the layout, unfortunately. So going through the process, if you watch the webinar prior to this one of converting from a mobile geodatabase to a file geodatabase, you'll need to go through that process again here, which we will work through. And so now we'll want to make sure that the map frame coordinate system is correct for the local area, because we need to get coordinates. Oops. So it looks like I did this already, but you'll need to calculate the fields because we need to get these coordinates for the reports. And so once you've already calculated those fields, after you do that, be sure to sync it back, because that makes sure that those that data is now back into the feature service. And so once you've done that, as I mentioned, the next step would be to, for the geoprocessing tool. I have favorited my, or the mobile geodatabase to file geodatabase tool. And so I will go to where I have it stored. And then there's that mobile geodatabase. You can tell the training structured triage GISS edit in a long, lovely GUID. And then the output file geodatabase, I have actually, I brought up the GeoOps file namer and plugged in my fire name, which is demo, my fire number. It's the structure triage geodatabase with the date. So I'm going to use that. And I'm going to make sure that I put it in my incident data folder. If you would like, you could create a new folder for structured triage, but for today, I'm just going to put the geodatabase right into the incident data folder. And then run through that process, which is nice and quick. So once I've done that, now I need to resource or redirect these two feature classes right now. Let's see, to the same one that I just downloaded. So it's in my demo fire incident data. Sometimes it goes right to it, sometimes it doesn't. You just can't predict it. Not today. Okay, great. There we go. Look, it also sourced the highlighted feature as well. The highlighted feature will be used later in the layouts to run through the map series pages. Within this template is the layout, is the default layout. And in case it doesn't populate with, with any photos or with any data, you can go to the layout tab, the map series, and click spatial. And just make sure that we've got the structured triage map series. I thought I would have renamed that. Make sure you're using the correct layer. So this is the, unfortunately that they have the same name, but I know that this is the correct one that's pointed to the file geodatabase and not the mobile geodatabase. The name field, the index field for the map series, I'm using structured number because I know that the structured number is unique. I know that the folks in the field, they may not have entered in the street address. I know that that can sometimes be a problem when structures aren't labeled correctly. They don't know, they aren't labeled with street names and things like that. So we add a structured number field for the GISS or for the field user to give each structure a unique identifier. So that's what I'm going to use as the index field. And here in this layout properties, or the maps series layout properties, is where you can adjust the scale of this map. And so we'll refresh. Okay, so we've got photos. We've got the feature that is selected, is highlighted. And how you get that is from the map view in the highlighted feature. This should be done automatically when you repoint the layer to your file geodatabase. But if not, then go down to page query and make sure that this is selected as the same as your index feature was on the map series properties. And so that's highlighted. As you'll notice, the fire name is incorrect, and so we'll go to fire name properties, general. We'll label that. And also, it doesn't quite show it here, but the fire number is in the summary. You can adjust the spacing on that if you'd like. Let's see. You can continue to adjust the spacing if you'd like. Here you'll see the location is given with the address of the structure as well as the community that the structure is in or the subdivision. If this information is not populated, then that area will be blank. But here's where and why it's important to make sure that you calculate the coordinates because they're a main component for this report. Make this bigger, sorry. And so, as you can see, we have almost all of the fields filled in. The reason why there's a blank space here is because many of these fields are text fields, and we wanted to make sure that there was enough space for if a person was quite wordy with their descriptions of mitigation or defensible space, that they had the space to be able to continue with that. And so we'll run through just to make sure that all features have their photos displayed correctly. Oh, how'd that get in there? And say hi to Murphy. As you'll notice though, in the map, not every structure is within that map frame. And so as I mentioned before, one way to alter the scale of that is in the layout properties. And so I can adjust that to make sure that within this small community, all features are displayed. The highlighted feature displays in the center. And so that is where this structure is. There are some issues oftentimes with photos. In the survey, in the survey 123 form, we ask that the field user take photos landscape. Sometimes they'll take them portrait. And so you'll have to adjust that here. And so you can do that rotate and flip. That's one thing that might go wrong here for troubleshooting. Another issue is that sometimes the names for these images, when Survey 123 populates them, oftentimes the name is a little bit different each time. And that can dictate whether or not that photo will display here. Oftentimes there are issues where that photo just won't pop up. And one way to check and to change that is with this filter. For instance, for some reason for photo number one, it doesn't like for any text or any alphanumerics to be in this filter. But for photo number two, it doesn't mind that it says image two. It doesn't seem to matter what the attachment is named. So we have structure triage image, and then structure triage image two. And then in the layout, it doesn't seem to matter as long as the photos pop up. So that's one of the troubleshooting attempts if some things go wrong here. Additionally, as I mentioned, getting the highlighted feature to work for the selected page on the map series. The most common way to resolve that is to use the structure number field. If the folks in the field are not using that, this is a good time for the GISS to label these. I've just changed them 1 through 5, so they're unique. The highlighted feature does not work quite well with the page query if the index feature has values that are either null or if they're duplicates. So keep that in mind. And then, of course, I didn't mention this, but of course you need to save this pro project, and you can save that into your demo fire, to your projects. You can use your namer. Can name it. And then last but not least, you can export. We'll share and share the layout. And then these are your export properties. And then map series, which is important, whether or not you would like all 5 pages, individual pages or whatnot. So you can export them as a single PDF or multiple PDF files. So that's pretty slick. This file, this project will be saved, zipped and saved, and then posted to the to that group, to the NIFSI survey files and reports group. And also, keep in mind that there is a workflow in here for that as well. There's a workflow to create a NIFSI org survey 123 form from a template. Lots of workflows. Another way to get structured triage data as a file geodatabase is to download and extract the data from AGOL, from the map viewer itself. So you can open up the web map viewer template, or you can open up your incident template as well. The structured triage layer is embedded in all of the template web maps. It's turned off by default. Feel free to turn that on if you like, or the field user can turn that on if they like. And so in the GISS role, you have access to this analysis button, these analysis tools, manage data, extract data, for triage, same as display. I would like to save it as a file geodatabase. And then And then, as it says, the data extracted and will be available in your content. So I've run through this process already. And then in your content, you get a nice file geodatabase. You can also use that in the pro project to source your data. You can import that in and point it to that. However, when you do that, there's no way to sync back directly to this, to the feature service, to the hosted feature service. You've been disconnected with that extract. And so if you were to update the coordinates, the Latin longs for those features, then you would have to go through that process again. You would have to bring in the mobile feature service and then sync that data again. So that's why there are two ways to do this, but making sure that you get those coordinates and get those back into the feature service is the best way.